Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. We have apologies this morning from the convener, and so as deputy convener I will be chairing this meeting. We also have apologies from Mark Ruskell, MSP. Agenda item one is a decision on taking item four, a work programme paper, in private. Is the committee agreed to take that paper in private?
Yes.
We are agreed. We move to our second item on the agenda then, which is further consideration of the Scottish Government's resource spending review. We are joined this morning by an online panel of witnesses. They are as follows: Kirsty Cumming, Chief Executive, Community Leisure UK; Duncan Dornan, Head of Museums and Collections, Glasgow Life; Carol Calder, Interim Audit Director from the Performance Audit and Best Value team in Audit Scotland. Can I welcome you all to the meeting? And if I may start with a couple of questions, and this first question is for all three of you. There has been criticism in the past, especially from our predecessor committee in 2019, around the consistency of local authority approaches to interpreting what adequate provision means for recreational, sporting, cultural and social activities. Can I ask all of you, what's your understanding of the phrase adequate provision? And do you feel that it has been interpreted inconsistently? And I don't know who wants to start us off, but perhaps we go to Katie Cumming, first of all. Kirsty Cumming, can you hear me? Would you like to comment on my question, or should I go to someone else? Would perhaps Duncan Dornan, would you like to comment on the question?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question, I beg your pardon.
Okay, I'll start again. There's been criticism in the past, including from our predecessor committee in 2019, around the consistency of local authorities when they approach the interpretation of the phrase adequate provision and what that means for recreational, sporting, cultural and social activities. What's your understanding or experience of the phrase adequate provision, and do you feel that it has been interpreted inconsistently?
I think that's a very challenging question. The definition of adequate provision obviously is determined in part by the circumstances of the local authority and the locality in which it finds itself, and therefore the demand which is generated by those audiences and by those communities. So I think that's a highly variable phrase, which I think underlies the difficulty in answering that question. What represents adequate provision in a rural, very diverse community, very dispersed community, will be significantly different from that in a much more densely packed urban area. So I think there are fundamental difficulties in local authorities interpreting that phrase in a consistent manner.
And in your experience in Glasgow, how has it been interpreted?
In Glasgow, we have a very large city with a very diverse population and a very significant tourist industry to support. And therefore, Glasgow has a very ambitious cultural offer and ambitious sporting offer. And that reflects the scale of the city, the diversity of demand in the city, the ability of culture and sporting activity to underpin a sense of place, to underpin inward investment, and to address some of the social and health issues and economic issues that exist in the city. And so Glasgow has responded, as you'll be aware, with relatively high expenditure over a long period of time, but that is using culture and sport as a mechanism to address some of those fundamental issues. That the challenges in Glasgow, of course, are significantly different to other parts of Scotland.
Okay. Can I turn to Kirsty Cumming for review, if you can hear me, Kirsty?
Thank you. Yes, I can hear you loud and clear now. Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, very much echoing Duncan's point around the challenges of the definition and the different interpretation across local authorities being dependent on populations, geography, the relationship with local authorities. So there is quite a variation in terms of how that definition is applied. But I think the underpinning kind of principles are around access to culture. So ensuring that everybody, wherever they are in Scotland, has access to cultural opportunities, be that a library, be that performance, be that museum exhibitions. So I think it is interpreted in different ways. And I think that there's, you know, that reflects the different makeup of local authorities and the needs of their communities as well, being, as Duncan said, very diverse communities across Scotland with different needs. But I think the important thing is around inclusive and accessible offerings right across the country where possible.
And lastly, Carol Calder, please.
Thank you. I don't think it's a terribly helpful definition to have adequate provision. It's not something that we can audit in any way because of the reasons that Mr. Dornan and Ms. Cummins have given the committee. So it's inevitable that there will be inconsistency. It is so contextual that it's hard for us to be able to measure what is adequate provision and then apply whether report on whether or not that has been met or not.
Okay. Can I move on? And this question is really directed at Audit Scotland and Ms. Calder, but I'd be interested in other views as well. Ms. Calder, the Account Commission's 2021 overview of... the Audit Commission's 2021 overview of local government highlighted the value of partnership working and empowering communities to deliver services that meet local needs. And I just wondered, how do you feel the work of local authorities and ALIOs doing that community-based work works alongside what's been done nationally by national agencies and programmes who are trying to do the same thing?
I think that there's a lot more that could be done in terms of community empowerment. And I think if we try and take COVID out of the equation, I think that there was a lot of activity in councils working in partnership with ALIOs to provide those local services. And I would suggest that the people that know best about what local services are needed and the local context are local authorities and councils and local partners and third sector. We don't have any reporting that we've done recently that can draw any conclusion to answer your question about how well they're working together with national partners. But I would say that it's a very important role for local authorities and their communities and their local partners in providing services for communities. So I think that the two should work together, but I can't give you any clear answer about how well that is working, because we haven't done any audit work in that area.
Okay, but do you sense that they should work together, but you found no evidence of there being an overlap or duplication or any kind of tension? Is that fair?
I wouldn't be able to say one way or the other, because we haven't done any work in that area. What I would say is that, so I can't comment on duplication, I really don't know, but I think that there is real opportunity for those national bodies, national organisations, to be working collaboratively with local partnerships to deliver services. Whether that is the case and whether there is duplication, I simply don't have anything, any evidence to support one way or the other.
Okay. Do either of our other witnesses want to comment on the local authority approach and the national approach and the interplay between them? Duncan Dornan, would you like to comment?
Yes, thank you. The engagement of communities and community-driven provision is enormously important and still has enormous growth necessary to make that fully inclusive and to allow full-scale engagement. I don't think that there is overlap or competition between national agencies and local authority provision. I think the field still has enormous growth left to get to that point where there is competition. I think the challenge for community engagement is that it's intensive work. It takes a lot of time to build confidence and to fully empower communities. and they often require professional support and access to core facilities, fundamental infrastructure, and obviously financial pressure has an impact on that. So I think that has slowed the rate of progress. There is progress. I don't think there is competition between national government and local authorities in that sphere.
That's very helpful. And lastly, Kirsty Cumming, do you have any observations on that?
Yeah, I mean, my observation would be similar, that I don't think there's, we've not sensed any competition or duplication as such. I think there's opportunities for perhaps closer alignment, you know, particularly if we look at the culture strategy, you know, and how that, you know, kind of that strategy at national level is, you know, adopted and embedded at local authority level, you know, what the kind of what that looks like in terms of local authority provision kind of feeding up into a national strategy. And I don't think that connection is yet as strong as it could be. So there's perhaps potential there. I think the other comment I would make is, you know, certainly from the perspective of our membership, you know, they are all kind of independent charities that have independent boards. So they have a really strong connect to communities by having kind of community representation on the boards. And there is also the role for trust to work with local partners and to kind of offer facilities and take a bit of a role around culture and kind of place at a local level as well, which is working quite well in most areas.
Thank you for that. I'm now going to turn to colleagues and start with Sarah Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. I wanted to kick off with a question as to whether we think we need core funding for community and cultural facilities. They're clearly integral to successful outcomes in delivering wider mental health and wellbeing benefits, but the evidence we've had shows you that the pressures on councils financially over the last decade particularly impacting libraries, which is a key service for young people to be able to read, overcome educational inequalities, gain confidence, and also for access for older people or people accessing digital services. And the Accounts Commission said that cultural services are not statutory funding, so face cuts, sorry, quote, budget restrictions when local authorities face pressures. So, you know, is there an issue here about core funding for local authorities to be part of that process to do the heavy lifting that was mentioned by lots of our witnesses in the budget evidence at the community level to do the interconnection that some of you talked about? Maybe start with Carol Calder from Audit Scotland.
Thank you for that. Yes, is the short answer. I think there is an issue about core funding. We know that over the past 10 years from local government benchmarking framework data, that the smaller services, and when I say smaller, I'm really talking about all the council services that are not social care, adult care and education, have all borne the brunt of cuts. So we know that over the last 10 years that the only services that have had a net increase in expenditure in budgets are social care and education. Of the other services, culture and leisure have taken the biggest cut. There's not a lot in it, but we're talking almost 30% over the last 10 years. Other services like planning, roads, also very high up in the mid-20s. So all of these services have reduced in funding. And that trend is an increasing trend. If we take the one-off COVID funding out of 2021, then there is a net decrease for councils in budget. And over the past 7 years, we've reported in our local government overview, our financial local government overview came out earlier this year. And over the past 7 years, although there's been a 7% real terms increase in funding, if you take out that one-off COVID funding, it's actually a 4.2% decrease in funding for councils overall. And that is at odds with the funding for Scottish Government. So that budget has gone up in that period of time, but the funding for councils has gone down. And I'm thinking about this in wider context. Mm-hmm. Within that context, councils are dealing with multiple pressures. There are backlogs following COVID. There is an increase in demand. We're dealing with an ageing population, increasing poverty, increasing cost of living. It's a very complex and uncertain environment in terms of policy direction, the new National Care Service, reform in education, and child poverty and climate change. All of these pressures are on local government and the funding has gone down. So what's happening is that those smaller services are bearing the brunt of funding cuts.
That's really helpful, thanks, and very clear as well in terms of the evidence. So if I then say, well, 10 years on after the Christie Commission report, which basically said we need more investment in these kind of services to deliver on health and well-being, supporting people from mental health issues, especially as we do come out of the pandemic, given the pressures, shouldn't we be seeing more of a focus on those services to enable that community investment to deliver on the transformative change that Christie recommended? Both the Auditor General and the Interim Chair of the Accounts Commission were very strong on this. So how, from your perspective, what does need to change in terms of that capacity for local government to have that expenditure to put directly into Christie Commission, which would then take pressure off the immediate frontline challenges?
I think that the core funding is an issue. I think also that multi-year funding, longer councils are not really able to fund long term. I know that I can't speak for COSLA, but I do know that COSLA's position is that the flexibility in the funding that they're given in councils is reduced year on year. Now, the Scottish Government have a very different position on this. It depends on what you consider to be ring-fenced. So the Scottish Government take a defined view of ring-fenced, which is money that's for a very specific purpose. And they suggest that about 8% of the budget is ring-fenced. COSLA's position is that it's more like 60% when you take into account money that is funding with that's given with policy expectations, where there's statutory services that need to be delivered, and when there are demand-driven services like health and social care. So when all of that is taken out of the equation, costs will calculate there's only 40% of the budget that is left with flexibility about how they spend it. So I think it's two things. I think it's both the funding settlement and it's the certainty of funding over multiple years so that councils are more able to plan how they deliver services. But if I add to that, I think it also requires a different definition or a different thinking about what we consider to be health funding, because health is much broader than the NHS. There's councils and many of the council services, but including community and culture services, which are about well-being and community connectedness, they can actually, investment in those services can actually reduce the demand on other core services of health. So it would be interesting to understand Public Health Scotland's perspective on that as well. I think that would be maybe something the committee might wish to consider, but that's the three things that I would suggest. It's the core funding, the multi-year certainty to allow for longer-term planning, and a wider definition about what is health spending.
That's really helpful. Thank you so much for that, Carol. If I could then pick up on those points and take them to our other witnesses, and maybe start with Kirsty Cumming, because you make some of those kind of points in your submission about how we see that community investment to actually see the investment on the ground. You've talked about significant loss of reserves across public culture charities, and the solvency issue coming through the pandemic, and then the future pressures. So do we need core funding, more investment, and how would you link that through to the preventative investment, which actually brings multiple benefits and looking at the outcomes rather than just the inputs?
Absolutely. I mean, I think the previous witness talked about core funding for services and the disproportionate cuts to culture and indeed leisure as non-kind of ring-fenced services, and that's absolutely what we've seen. And we appreciate that local authorities are under huge amounts of pressure, but from the perspective of ensuring and protecting services, there really needs to be core funding on the longer term as well, so kind of long-term funding agreements to ensure that these services are both protected in the immediate term and as we emerge from COVID, but in the longer term are able to actually kind of rebuild and really fulfil the role that they have the potential to do within communities. I mean, we talked about in our submission, and as you've mentioned, the loss of reserves. So from the perspective of our membership, entering the next financial year, there's no real financial safety net. Those reserves were used up to kind of support through the pandemic and to kind of remain solvent and remain functioning through the pandemic. But if there's further pressures, and we know there's already been talk around some of the pressures that are coming, you know, particularly energy increases is a significant one for our members in terms of the size, scale, age of buildings that they're operating. That's going to have quite a significant impact in the short term. And there's not a financial, as I said, there's not reserves there that are really available for our members to dip into. So there needs to be support from somewhere else, be that local authorities who are already under extreme financial pressure or other sources of funding. But I guess that's a kind of short-term sort of view. In the longer term and the discussion around health, well-being, I mean, well-being is an interesting word. That's the word that our members use to describe what they do. They very much see themselves as well-being organisations, and culture, leisure is the kind of delivery mechanism for well-being. So it's kind of a bit of a change of positioning over the years to where we are now. But there certainly needs to be a better connection across portfolios. And, you know, and it's already been mentioned again around health being, I guess it's viewed maybe as a treatment service, the NHS, but actually there needs to be a much more of a shift towards prevention. We've got the evidence base around the contribution that culture can make. We've got evidence around some of the pilots that have taken place and the role that it can have if it was to be properly scaled, properly resourced. But at the moment, there's just not the resource or the funding to really roll that out in a meaningful way. So we absolutely know that it could do much more in terms of supporting health, well-being for communities, but it's absolutely stretched at the moment. And I guess my kind of final points on this would be just consideration around protection of services at the moment as well. You know, we are seeing changing customer behaviours. We are seeing extreme financial pressures. What we really want to avoid is short-term decision-making that, you know, looks to save money in you know, this year into the next couple of years, but actually may lose services in the long term. We really need to look at a long-term view of culture, the outcomes, where we want to get to, and a bit of a roadmap of how to get there. Otherwise, we are at risk of losing assets, services, but also the skills and expertise. We've seen quite a loss over the last 2 years, people exiting the sector. We really need to understand the role of culture more broadly across portfolios.
Okay, that comes across very clear, that core funding, but also multi-year funding to planning ahead and deliver. Can I ask Duncan the same questions about both the funding aspect, but also the impact on wellbeing, preventative help that was highlighted by the Christie Commission?
They're very substantial points, thank you. And I would echo the comments of the previous contributors about the trajectory of our budgets over the last 10 years. We've seen a real terms reduction in budgets. That has, however, happened alongside the substantial growth in the use of our services, with museum footfall increasing by around 50% over the same period. This has the effect of reducing the net cost per visit, which is very encouraging, but obviously puts enormous pressure on facilities. The budget impact has been ongoing, and we're now at a stage where we seriously risk the loss of professional skills and infrastructure capacity to sustain these services in the longer term. I think that's particularly problematic given the substantial impact we know that services have on health and wellbeing, and that's even more the case post-pandemic, where we have increased levels of mental health issues, isolation, and also the economic dislocation. Cultural services in the recovery from a pandemic, an environment where retail has been very badly affected, and many city centre businesses in particular are struggling to recover after the series of lockdowns we were obliged to have, will require cultural infrastructure as we have drawn people back into the city centre to regenerate them to maintain economic life. We're in a position where, in fact, cultural services are not in a position to bounce back and to be able to sustain this. They're simply struggling to maintain their current levels of delivery. So I think the point made about core funding is extremely important. A period of stability is also essential to understand the funding scheme over the next 3 years would be enormously valuable and allow planning and to look at the mix of public funding and commercial funding. But we're in a situation now after 10 years of steady reductions in funding where services are hanging on by their fingernails, and that's when we're not in a position to be able to respond effectively to demands that are being placed upon us.
That's very clear. And if you want to do the community investment, the community prescribing, where are you fixed for being able to deliver on that agenda?
That's hugely important, but as I mentioned earlier, that level of engagement is in the first instance very expensive, and that means it's very difficult to divert scarce resources to do that whilst maintaining existing services to other citizens. So that requires investment. We believe very strongly that the benefits are enormous, and there's very, very clear evidence to support that. However, we need to identify this preemptive investment in addressing health and wellbeing issues before they become clinical has to be prioritised and has to be funded to make it truly effective.
So, pretty consistent feedback from the witnesses there. Thank you very much, all of you. Back to the convener.
Thank you. Can I turn next to Maurice Golden, please?
Thank you, convener. And perhaps I could start with Carol Calder. I think in your answers to Sarah Boyack, you were quite clear about the funding side of things and the picture there, but I wondered if you've assessed the costs aspect and, you know, the inflationary pressures both on energy, on wages, on building infrastructure, and how that could potentially squeeze service delivery.
The short answer to that is no, we haven't done that. We haven't done any specific audit work in culture services for some time now. The information that I have is the overview of local government. So it's local government finances and looking at the spend patterns in local government. Those figures are corrected for inflation. And the data that I was talking about uses the SPICE method for correcting, so the average inflation over the period. But as in terms of energy costs and specifics of wage costs and so on and so forth, we haven't done any work in that area, I'm afraid.
Okay, and you mentioned about ring fencing, but at least part of, even within the leisure and culture space, is the requirement for retrofitting to become more energy efficient and meet our net zero targets. Within that space, which is clearly going to drive up costs for the right reasons, is there any work or is there any plans to look at how that might impact leisure and cultural services?
We have a programme of work that is looking at net zero, specifically achieving net zero in councils. That may cover elements of culture and leisure services, but it's not a specific focus of a work programme at the moment.
Okay, thank you for that. Perhaps if we move on to Kirsty Cumming. Kirsty, in a similar vein, I wonder, and you touched on it in your earlier answer, but if you could say perhaps how costs are increasing, but also specifically within the culture and leisure estate, that net zero requirement for buildings is going to drive up costs irrespective of the costs that you may see increasing anyway at the moment. So I'd be keen for your views on that.
Yeah, thank you. I guess I'll split it into two parts. The first part in terms of general increasing costs. There's a number of factors at play here. One is the return rates and kind of restarting of events, particularly income generating events on the culture side. So those tend to be, you know, live performance events, festivals, that can actually reinvest some of the profits into cross-subsidising other cultural services that are free to access. So because those have been obviously delayed as a result of the COVID restrictions and combined with perhaps still some anxiety amongst the public to return, the return rates are certainly lower than they were pre-COVID and not expected to get back to pre-COVID levels for quite some time. We don't expect to see a return to kind of 100% of pre-COVID levels until 2023 at the earliest. Wow. So there will be an impact there on income through customer footfall and also the secondary spend that also supports a lot of our members. So obviously accessing museums and libraries is free, but a lot of the income that's generated is through those secondary spends, you know, gift shops, cafes, etc., activities that are taking place. So there is an impact in terms of income there. there's also increased costs, I guess the other side, increased costs in terms of some of the COVID protocols that are still in place. So there is obviously still enhanced cleaning, PPE equipment, face masks, etc., still being used within our members. So there is obviously a higher operational cost required to kind of run venues and facilities. And then there's the other kind of wider factors that are not specific to culture around the increases to national living wage, which is increasing by 6%. That's a significant increase. And that has a knock-on effect for pay rates across the rest of the organisations. It's quite a significant pay rate, plus the inflation rates being so high at the moment. And then there's energy, which has obviously been touched on, which is going to be a critical factor going forwards for our members. And then the other kind of, again, on sort of costs and income, management fees is obviously a critical part for our members. The management fees that they receive from local authority partners, those are moving back towards reductions. We've seen additional funding through COVID to kind of maintain organisations. However, we are predicting, we know actually for 2022-23 that there will be a move towards reductions in management fees, which were kind of planned pre-COVID. So we're moving back towards that decrease in budgets. And our estimates from what we hear from members is that's up to 50% reductions over the next 4 to 5 years. So it is a significant reduction. So from our perspective, 2022-23 looks like it will be stable for members. We're not seeing a crisis, and I use the term crisis to mean really kind of at the point of insolvency. But in the next 3 to 5 years, it's going to really be at the point where things have to be cut, and that's going to be a real challenge. There will be decisions that will be made that are not decisions that anybody wants to have to make around maintaining services if we continue on the current trajectory around cuts, which we think that we are moving towards. And then I guess kind of on the second part of your question around environments and, kind of the net zero. So we're kind of at early stages with our membership in terms of exploring how we support, around this. I guess there's a lot of unknowns at the moment in terms of what is the best technology that can be used, but also what is the investment that is required. So there is going to be a need for investments and kind of refurbishment, retrofitting of facilities, venues, etc. What the cost is, I don't think anybody has a clear idea as yet. So it's kind of moving through to understand what that looks like, with the expectation of it will be, I guess, significant, as it will be for other sectors as well. And particularly heritage venues, particularly buildings that were perhaps built. We've got a lot of 1970s kind of infrastructure across Scotland that probably needs a lot of upgrading and investment to get anywhere near to where we want it to be in terms of that emissions perspective, but an ongoing piece of work for us, so nothing too concrete on that as yet.
Thanks for that, Kirsty. Perhaps we'll move on to Duncan Dornan next, and again, just what's your thoughts in terms of inflationary pressures and increases in costs? And in addition, has there been any assessment? I think particularly for museums and collections, the costs of retrofitting could run up into millions of pounds if you're going to keep this similar building infrastructure.
It's a very good question. Obviously, the impact of the financial pressure over the last 10 years has been significant, particularly significant in relation to building maintenance and infrastructure, which is an area which can often be delayed. And so we move into this period of staggering energy inflation, not in a particularly good position. And if we look beyond the current cost crisis to achieving net zero, we aren't uniformly moving forward on that at all. We know from what we've recently done in the borough that a great deal can be achieved, but that requires investment in an old iconic buildings, even 80s iconic buildings, significant investment in remodelling of the buildings to really achieve substantial energy gains, given that we're unable to deliver often even fairly basic maintenance. That's something that it seems almost impossible to identify how that would move forward. The creeping financial pressure And the impact that's had on our ability to invest and to plan how we react cannot be overstated. If we're simply trying to keep the doors open on a year-by-year basis, very difficult to step up back from that and start to look in the longer term about how an estate might evolve. And I think that is, as I mentioned before, one of the challenges. Most of our buildings are critical public infrastructure. Mm-hmm. They serve an enormous range of needs for communities and provide enormous opportunity and cohesion for communities. If these buildings are to be sustained into net zero, they will require significant investment. We need a longer-term strategy carefully planned to enable us to do that. And currently, with annual funding and declining annual funding, that simply isn't possible.
Thanks for that, Duncan. Very helpful. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I turn next to Alistair Allen, please?
Thank you, Convener. Questions again for Duncan Dornan, although perhaps he might be able to speak for the culture sector more widely, if I can ask him to do that. There's been quite a discussion about what place-based culture means, and we've had, I think, some written evidence giving a definition of that. Place-based working is a person-centred, bottom-up approach used to meet the unique needs of people in one given location. That was from Charity Iris. So, what do you understand that to mean? How do we celebrate, genuinely celebrate, local culture, local contributions that can be made to the cultural life? I'm not, I hasten to add, as I've done before, making a case against money going to national companies or anything like that. But in budgeting terms, how do cultural institutions get that balance right?
I think it's a very good question, and it seems to me, and it's certainly our practice in Glasgow, is that engagement with local communities and individuals and communities is absolutely fundamental to how we operate, even in an institution which has a national role and an international role and draws an international audience. And for any cultural activity, it's essential to have the voice of local people represented in that activity. And that our content, our collecting, our interpretation is driven by engagement with local people. That sense of local and sense of place is enormously vital in addressing the health and wellbeing issues within a community. But equally, for someone coming to Scotland or coming to one of our cities, one of our museums, to get a clear sense that the institution genuinely represents local people and is actually part of their lives and part of their cultural experience is really fundamental. So although that this is often presented as something new, I would suggest that actually for any successful institution historically, this was pretty fundamental. I think our approach is now more sophisticated, and I think our audiences are more than open to that. People are very enthusiastic and keen to be involved. And certainly in the work we've done in refurbishing the borough, and particularly working with non-users of the museum in pre-closure, we found enormous enthusiasm to involve with that collection and for people to have their voices heard within new displays. So I think, although this clearly, when it's explained, sounds like a very local thing, providing local content and local experience, actually that sense of place and that personal voice, I think, is really fundamental to any institution, whether they're local or national. And that's what gives us the authenticity, which is actually fundamental to promoting Scotland to the wider world.
Thank you. When you mentioned the wider world, you lead me nicely into the other issue I was going to ask about, which is obviously Scotland is presently preparing to welcome people from Ukraine, we hope, in the coming days. Do you think, again, this touches on budgeting, do you think that cultural institutions need to start thinking about how to celebrate the culture that they are going to bring with them, but also how to involve people in that community in the work that you're already doing?
I think that's absolutely essential. As you'll be aware, Glasgow has had a significant number of people who've come to the city over the last few decades from other countries and have increased our population. We've worked very closely with these communities to give them a voice and tell them to represent themselves in our institutions and also to Glasgow and to the wider world. We know from their feedback that that's felt to be hugely important. One of the things which gives people a sense of dignity and a sense of belonging is if they see themselves represented in the city and the nation's cultural institutions. So in addition to all of the tangible things we do for Ukrainians, I would suggest it's absolutely fundamental that we engage them with our cultural institutions as quickly as we can, to recognise their presence in our communities, but also to give them a sense of dignity and a voice to express their own experience and to explain where they've come from and why they're here to the wider communities. But without doubt, one of the greatest things we can do to reach out our hands and to give a sense of belonging is to ensure that people are represented and their voices are represented in our cultural institutions.
Thank you, Convener.
And can I turn to Jenny Minto, please?
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, panel. I'd like to draw out a bit more on the collaboration side of things. We took some evidence from Sen Scott, who suggested there might be a tension between local leadership within communities and how you work with grassroots organisations. So I'm interested to see how you collaborate with local organisations and also specifically around around COVID. We've heard throughout the session of examples where local grassroots organisations have pivoted with support of larger, you know, the local authorities, but there's been a quick, and so I'm interested to hear how local authorities perhaps have changed the way that they you deliver your cultural side of things, and so what learnings from COVID there have been. So perhaps Duncan, start with you.
That's a very good question. The way in which we operate with community groups has been evolving over a very long period of time. In Glasgow, we established the Open Museum almost 30 years ago, which was expressly to work with people who couldn't or wouldn't visit museums. And they've been developing and involving their methodology over that whole period of time. We've moved to a position now where the default in our service should be to work with communities in developing content rather than the exception. So we would, in museums, expect all of our curators to work with a community group wherever possible to inform the collecting process, to inform the development of content and an interpretation, to ensure that what we're seeing is authentic, but also to make sure that we've fully engaged those communities in using those civic services that we provide. So they become a fundamental part of that. One of the major challenges is in establishing trust and confidence, because this is still not universal. It takes time for people to accept that we genuinely mean we wish them to have a voice in the institution and that we genuinely want to co-produce and work alongside them as equal partners. And I think as institutions, we still have a way to go and a lot to learn. That's a difficult transition to make, just as communities need time to have confidence in that. But we do know from the evidence of the work we've done that it really does work. It has significant benefits for communities, and I believe has significant benefits for the institution in providing that authentic mm-hmm. representation of our communities and our cities, which otherwise we can't do. Mm-hmm. So this is hugely beneficial, and I would suggest a relatively cost-effective way to integrate communities, provide greater cross-community insight, and at the same time promote health and well-being, which of course we know culture does. There's a huge prize to be gained there. Our challenge is that this is the most difficult work we do because it's labour intensive. It takes time to build confidence. And we have to have public services on which we can cooperate to be able to drive that cooperation and that partnership.
That's helpful. Before I was elected, I managed a small museum on Islay, and I think trying to spread the love, I suppose, of objects that are held within Scotland in the national institutions is building that trust and confidence to work with local organisations so that an object that you might have that's appropriate to somebody that grew up on Islay, it would be wonderful to get, you know, that out. And it's just understanding how you do that. But I think it is right about the trust and confidence. Thank you. Kirsty, just wondering about, from your perspective as well, what we've been through clearly a really difficult time with COVID, but we've changed the way that some things are done. So I'm interested to know what you've learnt. You did suggest as well that you had lots of good evidence examples of where social prescribing and preventative. So I wonder if you could maybe share a few of them with us, if possible.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I think there's a lot that has been learnt. There's a lot of positives in a strange way from COVID, but in terms of the opportunity to actually pause and reflect, you know, obviously things had to close for a period of time, and it was looking at new ways to engage people. So there's been a real drive, towards digital, which was probably at the early stages for some of our members, certainly pre-COVID, but that's been expedited. And we've seen, huge numbers of people accessing library services, as an example, a huge increase in appetite for libraries, looking at new ways to kind of deliver classes, social isolation. We've seen online coffee mornings, so really a lot of our members have looked at some of the social side, why do people want to attend some of the cultural events? And a lot of it's the social connection, as much as it is the actual cultural engagement. So it's how to kind of make sure that people feel safe and connected through some of that. So there's definitely been learning around maybe some of the technology that can be used. I think a lot of our members are using hybrid kind of approaches at the moment, and some of that will stay going forward. It's equally, understanding, what doesn't really work as well. So if we look at kind of live performance, for example, a lot of the feedback has been that it's about the atmosphere of being, in a place with other people, and that kind of joint sense of kind of connection, watching something together, which with the best will in the world doesn't really translate to somebody watching something being streamed in their house on their own. So I guess it's in a strange way highlighted the real sort of mental health benefits that come through. And I think from a public perception as well, I think we people that work in the sector have absolutely understood, a lot of the benefits around mental health, well-being, social isolation. But in the kind of public side, I think people are much more aware of their own mental health coming out of the pandemic, but also the role of culture, seeing the benefits that they actually get from going to a library, from going to a museum, from taking part, going and experiencing live performance, and actually understanding that it's not just, a leisure activity, but actually benefits their health as well. And I think that that's important that we kind of build on that and we don't lose sight of those kind of well-being benefits while they are slightly more present perhaps in people's minds as we come out of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. So I guess there's a bit of an opportunity there. And in terms of the social prescribing and, kind of well-being prevention side, there's a whole wealth of work that's going on across our members at the moment. There's some really interesting work taking place in Highland at the moment around social prescribing, working with Edinburgh University around the cultural prescribing and looking to roll that out. We've got our member in Fife on Fife who deliver books on prescription, social prescribing, which is a really well evidenced programme. I think one of the challenges that we have on the cultural side, obviously we have physical activity referrals and things like that, which are perhaps more widespread, but on social prescribing, it's the availability of venues and spaces, for facilities to be open 7 days a week, for people to be able to access, and a consistency of offer is perhaps more challenging than it is for somebody to take part in a physical activity where there are gyms that are, tend to be open in most places longer hours. But actually, if we look at, referrals into art, for example, that's probably more dependent on where somebody lives as to whether there is that opportunity locally for them to access. So there's definitely the evidence base that sits behind it, and there's some great practice going on, but what we need is to be able to scale that much more across Scotland and see it as the prevention and really put some kind of investment to make sure that people are not prejudiced by where they live in terms of what they can access.
That's very helpful, Kirsty. Thank you. I was at a concert at the weekend and it was notable to see people together and the smiles and the enjoyment that people were actually experiencing. If I may turn to Carol, I'm interested to find out how Audit Scotland value, how it's easy to audit numbers that my colleague Maurice Golden was talking about, but how do you audit value added in respect to well-being, the softer benefits, I suppose?
We do, and we certainly try to do that. We do through a number of ways. Sometimes it's through our overview reports or thematic reports, and sometimes it's through our audits of individual bodies. So I'm more familiar with councils because that's my portfolio. would the Accounts Commission have said, I mean, in last year's local government overview 2021, it was very much focused on good practice examples about what was happening in communities, that councils were working with communities in terms of responding to the initial impact of the pandemic and the pivot towards digitalisation of services. There's lots of examples in that report. We're just preparing our report for 2022. And one of the case studies that we highlight is library services, and building on what the last witness was saying, we have seen such innovation in services across the board, but in libraries particularly. I mean, obviously the footfall, well, it ceased, but some of their online offering and more innovative approaches to delivering services, click and collect and home delivery and digital storybooks, online book clubs, all of these are activities to support mental health and wellbeing in communities. And the Commission has said in their last local government overview, and we'll be repeating the message, I think, in this one, is that councils need to consolidate on all of the learning and the innovation that was developed through the community engagement and the start of the pandemic. And the pace that we saw services, councils and community groups pivoting in order to provide services in a very different way, very quickly, was unprecedented. And I don't think we can underestimate how well those services did pivot to try and continue to deliver services in circumstances we've never experienced before. So we're definitely keen to ensure that that learning is consolidated. And the way that we audit that is through case studies and through our, we hold to account, but we also are about supporting improvement. So we do use case studies and examples about where councils or services and councils, where they've worked with partners, where they've worked with communities. Community empowerment is a big interest of the Accounts Commission and also the Auditor General. We've produced our principles for community empowerment last year, the year before. I'm not sure quite what year it was, but that was very well received. So we are looking at the way that in which communities and partners and third sector are involved in the design and delivery of council services, whether that be culture or otherwise. But I think there are some really good examples of where culture services have been fleet of foot and very much focused on mental health and wellbeing, and not to lose sight of that and not to lose all of those gains as we go back to a new normal.
That's great, Carol. Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you for that. If I may finish with a question that returns to the issue of funding. Obviously, there's been a lot of interest in a cross-portfolio approach to funding cultural services, with particular investment linked to health and wellbeing. And some examples have been given to the committee. For example, providing some level of core funding to cultural organisations from budgets outside the culture portfolio is one. Another is a project funding approach, which could allow organisations to build capacity for things like social prescribing, etc. I mean, is that kind of innovative approach to funding something you would support? And I'll start with Duncan Dornan, please.
Yes, thank you for that question. It is. The potential to support health and wellbeing and to work with other services is enormous, but that's not something we can respond to substantially from within the existing cultural funding. That is not adequate to sustain our services. I think we can potentially expand and focus our services on cultural prescribing and on reaching into communities where need is greatest. But that will require investment. That, as I said previously, that is some of the most difficult work that can be done. And I think to look at a cross-portfolio funding model to support that kind of activity would be hugely helpful. If not that, then certainly project funding, which looks specifically at delivering that. If we continue to attempt to deliver from within cultural funding, which is essentially what we've been doing for a substantial period of time, the progress will be painfully slow. We won't have the population level impact, which is really the thing that we want to try to get to.
Thank you. Kirsty Cumming, please.
Thank you. I mean, I think Duncan's articulated it very well, but I think that one of the key points that I would add is, you know, the impact of cuts, you know, a small, cut to funding in culture actually has a disproportionate impact in terms of what, you know, can be delivered. So it's actually being very mindful around, you know, making sure that we're not continuing on a trajectory of cuts and reductions, as well as it is looking at innovative funding.
And Carol Calder.
Just echo what the previous witnesses have said. I think from an Audit Scotland perspective, what we look at is what are your priorities and how does how do we see the funding streams change to meet those priorities? And so how does Scottish Government match funding to outcomes? So we try to track the money through, and I think where it comes from, which pot it comes from, is not really our concern. Our concern is to look at what are you trying to achieve, what are your priorities, and can we see that funding is moving towards those priorities?
Okay, thank you for those answers. Finally, the next panel we have is the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, Hamza Yousaf, and the Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, who are appearing in a joint panel. If you had to give them a message in a sentence, what would that message be? And if I could start with Kirsty Cumming.
A sentence is a challenge. but I suppose it would be there's probably three points for me. One is recognise and understand the value of culture, what it currently delivers in terms of health, well-being and wider benefits. The second one would be to look at the funding, look at kind of long-term core funding for these services to enable future delivery. And the third one is the flexibility to give time and space to understand the impact of the last 2 years on public behaviour and kind of the appetite for the ways in which people engage with culture, and to allow organisations time and space to adapt and have flexibility at a local level to make sure that what they're delivering is targeted and appropriate for their communities.
Duncan Dornan?
My message would be that the engagement with cultural services, we know it is hugely effective in improving health, well-being and economic outcomes. We need to find the courage to invest in developing that engagement to allow that to be manifest at population level. And if we do that, we can have a much healthier and more prosperous country, which is not reliant on clinical intervention and which will improve all of our economic potential. So I think that would be my statement, promoting culture and the benefits of our services.
And finally, I appreciate you come at this from a slightly different perspective, but Carol Calder.
I'm glad you came to me last. That's a heck of a question, but a really good one. And yeah, I think I could probably do a 45-page report in time, but trying to capture that in a sentence, I guess it's more about funding certainty for local government and appreciating the contribution that local government makes to health and well-being, as well as other sectors, and thinking about health in its broadest terms.
Thank you very much. Apologies for putting you all on the spot at the end there. But that concludes our discussion with you as a panel. Can I thank Kirsty Cumming, Duncan Dornan and Carol Calder for all your contributions this morning. It was a very, very helpful session. We finished this panel a little bit early and the Cabinet Secretaries are not yet available. So I'm going to move into private session until 10:25 and then we'll be back in public session for our final panel this morning. But for now, we move into private session. Thank you. go. Thank you and welcome back, everyone. Our next agenda item three, is a further and final panel on the Scottish Government's resource spending review. I'm delighted to say we're now joined in person by not one, but two Cabinet Secretaries and by their officials who are online. Can I welcome from the Scottish Government Angus Robertson, Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, and Hamza Yousaf, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care. Online, the officials joining us are Penelope Cooper, Director of Culture, Major Events and COVID Coordination, Erica Hawes, Wellbeing Team Leader, Wellbeing and Prevention Unit, and Rebecca Crook, Finance Business Partner, Health Finance. I believe that both Cabinet Secretaries wish to make brief opening statements, and can I ask you to be as concise as possible, and can I start with Hamza Yousaf, please.
Thank you so much. Convener, first of all, good morning to you, and I hope you and committee members are keeping safe and keeping well. I can be very brief. Let me thank the committee for their invitation to appear alongside my colleague Angus Robertson. When considering our budgetary decisions, it's important that we set this in context in terms of the key priorities, but also the key challenges that we're facing in the health and social care portfolio. I've just come from another committee of the Parliament and reiterated there that this week, I think it would be fair to say in my conversations with health boards up and down the country, is the most challenging week of the pandemic, one of the most challenging, but certainly the feedback we're getting is that it's extremely challenging. And that, of course, has been the context of the last couple of years throughout this pandemic. But as we look forward, we need to reform, of course, the NHS and social care. And how we do that and how we recover is clearly set out in the recovery plan. NHS boards are facing a population that is facing the accumulative effects of the last 2 years and all the health implications that come with that. They are facing a population that thankfully is living longer, but that does mean that they have more complex needs. Maintaining current services while clearing that pandemic backlog and while we're dealing with levels of staff absence, these are all the accumulative challenges. We also need to develop the National Care Service, which will require significant investment. Now, I don't say that in a way to say that, not to acknowledge the fact actually that the health and social care portfolio has the largest budget in government. I say that because we have to think bold, radically transformative in terms of that recovery. And I do believe that culture and the arts can play a role absolutely within that. Just as we know that physical activity can increase our mood, can help with sleep, can reduce stress and anxiety, undertaking cultural activities and the arts can undoubtedly have a range of benefits too. For example, bringing people closer together, it helps with reducing isolation. There's a clear potential for grassroots community interventions such as the Craft Cafe in my own constituency in Govan. I'm keen to explore the benefits of broader health and wellbeing activities, including the role that culture can play as part of our work on social prescribing. And I'm sure we'll get into the detail of that in committee. Our 2021-22 PFG, Programme for Government, made a commitment that by 2026, every GP practice in the country will have access to a mental health and wellbeing service, helping grow community health resilience and directing social prescribing at a grassroots level. The committee will be aware that in October last year, we launched the community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund for Adults, which has now increased to £21 million. And while local third sector interface partners are still processing the awards, we certainly expect that grassroots cultural activities will contribute to community wellbeing and benefit from that fund. And there's a range of examples, which again, I won't go into the detail of here, how that is already happening. So, well, and I'll conclude on this point, well, my overarching focus must be on revitalising our NHS and social care as we recover from the pandemic. I certainly see the benefits that cultural activities can bring to people's physical and mental health, not as a bolt-on, but actually as a really important integral part of that recovery and transformation. And we'll certainly work together closely. And we've already had a constructive meeting in this regard to see what more we can do to promote culture and the arts within our recovery and renewal of the NHS and social care.
And can I turn to Angus Robertson?
Thank you very much, Deputy Convener, and a pleasure as always to be back on, it seems, a weekly basis in front of the committee. I welcome the opportunity to discuss this morning the resource spending review for the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture portfolio, and in particular the important synergies between the cultural side of the portfolio and the health and social care portfolio. As the resource spending review proceeds, we want to hear about the experiences and views of the people who use public services and of those who help to deliver them. And it's helpful to have the committee's views drawing also on the evidence that you've received. There's in addition, as you know, a public consultation which closes on the 27th of March. The review is clearly an opportunity to bring about a longer-term financial planning to March 2026 for the bodies funded directly by government and organisations funded through those bodies. This is what the culture sector in particular has been seeking through evidence to your committee and its predecessor for some time. The committee is a champion for securing more resources for the portfolio it oversees. That is understandable for any subject committee. You'll not be surprised to hear, however, that I and my cabinet colleagues will face some difficult choices to live within the total resources without borrowing powers at our disposal. The pressures on public services continue to grow. To finish on a more positive note, the review does give us the opportunity to be discussing joint approaches at a strategic level, given the positive potential of culture to contribute to health and well-being outcomes. We're agreed how vital the contribution of culture is to our shared goals. Our culture strategy was published in February 2020, right before the start of the pandemic, which has disrupted its implementation. However, we still made significant progress. We've launched three new innovative programmes, the Culture Collective, Arts Alive and Creative Communities. Together, these are working to empower communities to develop cultural activities, to bring creative residences to education settings in areas of multiple deprivation, and use cultural projects as a positive diversion away from crime. We also launched the National Partnership for Culture, who have recently provided recommendations to ministers on the sector's recovery and renewal. The pandemic has shown us that the key message of the cultural strategy, that culture and creativity is valuable in its own right, and everyone in Scotland has the right to a cultural life, no matter where they live, is more important than ever. And culture is at the heart of who we are and also underpins our economic, social and even environmental prosperity. Culture is therefore something that all parts of government have a stake in. And on that basis, we've been working to develop closer cross-portfolio relationships, including with health and social care. And this is something that we will continue to prioritise.
Thank you very much to both of you for those opening statements. And we move now to questions. And if I can begin on that subject of cross-portfolio working, particularly when it comes to funding. Many witnesses before this committee have suggested that if we are truly focused on outcomes, that opportunities to take a cross-portfolio approach when it comes to funding cultural services are key. And we just heard in the last panel session from the Director of Museums and Galleries at Glasgow Live, who made quite a firm and powerful point that he could not rely on the culture spend alone to really power the cross-portfolio working in terms of health and well-being that he would like. And some examples have been given to us. So, for example, we've had examples of providing a level of core funding to cultural organisations from budgets outside the culture portfolio. We've also had examples of people preferring a project funding approach, which could allow organisations to do this cross-portfolio working. I mean, if I could ask you both for your observations on that, in terms of really, if we are to truly make this happen, then in terms of funding, it does require some kind of imaginative thinking. If I turn to the Cabinet Secretary for Health first.
First of all, I'll be really keen to look at that evidence and hear that evidence, and I will give it serious consideration, as I will do this committee's evidence. And it's right that we ensure that we take a cross-governmental approach to this work. And what I would say is, since I've been Health Secretary for the past 10 months, I've made it really clear to my officials, and I've made it clear to my colleagues across government, that we are not Fortress Health. That we are not going to have our arms around this, what is now going to be a £18 billion budget and just try to protect it for ourselves, because we absolutely understand the need to work cross-government, and that has been done previously, undoubtedly. But we want to expand upon that. And the work that the Deputy First Minister is doing and his role within government that reaches and that brings Cabinet colleagues together regularly. And trust me, if he has a sniff of siloed working, he's quick to make sure that that is dealt with. We're working in a way more collaboratively, more cross-governmental, more cross-portfolio than any other time before. So that's a positive. In terms of funding, we can already point to examples, and maybe we can go into this and as we go through this committee session. I could give you numerous examples of really good projects that are being funded by the health service and a lot of that by our mental health budget. To arts therapies, to community initiatives that are helping particularly young people actually with some of the effects of mental health. So where that requires budgets to be shared, and that's a strange way of looking at it, because you know we're one Scottish government, but where that needs to be, where the might and the muscle of the health budget can help with that, then absolutely. And of course, we have a really good report, as you know, the National Partnership for Culture's recommendations, I think published just yesterday. They have a number of recommendations about funding and funding streams. And again, I give an absolute commitment to look at those recommendations with an open mind.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary for Constitution.
Well, my first reflection would be this is very much work in progress. And the illustration that you gave about different preferences for how one might seek synergies or different funding arrangements is a good example of the fact that it is something which people have very different views on, and trying to find the appropriate way in and through government and through different parts of government is part of the challenge that we're trying to pick our way through. I think we're being very well advised at the moment. I made reference in my opening statement to a number of ways in which we are being advised to think about how we can mainstream, in my area in particular, culture and the arts in other parts of government. And obviously there's a particular focus today in the sort of broader health area. And I think the challenge for government is to work out how we can remain flexible and adapt to the different potential ways in which culture and the arts can help deliver in partnership with health. So I am extremely open-minded about how we do that. Myself and Cabinet Secretary Yusuf have already met to discuss on the basis of both of us being extremely open-minded about how we can do that. There are some really, really good examples of things working already. So I take heart from the fact that we're not trying to reinvent the wheel here. What we're trying to do is work out on the basis of a lot of the advice that there's been in recent years, particularly on the health, the mental health, well-being side of things, how we can then deliver that across the piece. That, I think, is a challenge for us all. And so we're not at an end point, but I think we're definitely at a stage where we're very keen to hear people's priorities. I know our civil service colleagues who are on the are part of this hearing as well, are extremely keen as well to learn from different stakeholders to make sure that we are remaining flexible, that we are thinking about the different ways that we can deliver on the basis of much that we're already doing, but where there's evidence of that which we should perhaps be thinking about in new ways. We are not set in old ways. We are keen to adopt best practice if we can, and that, and I keep on saying this at the committee, but it's a genuinely held view. Your advice on this issue, I'm very keen to hear about as well. Because we're in this kind of, we're in this sweet spot at the moment of a place where we are thinking about all of this, we are trying to find the mechanisms to make this work, and the examples that you might give, and that might come out through questioning, but it may come out through your report as well, is something that we are very much looking forward to.
Thank you for that. If I could turn back to the Cabinet Secretary for Health and pose a question that I posed to the Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution a few months ago, which is this question. There are examples of good practice, and you gave some examples of programs that are existing in terms of art, work in culture. But it strikes me that we really need a kind of paradigm shift, particularly something like primary care, for example. How do we get GPs to prescribe a trip to a gallery or a museum or an arts event of some sort? How do we actually achieve that in terms of shifting mentality? Because we can all think of really good examples of that happening, anecdotally, but it strikes me we need a much greater shift, system shift. And I just wonder if you have any views on that.
Yeah, I agree with you, because you're right. I could give you tens of examples of where I think it's being done well across the country, but whether actually we're doing that more systemically is the question. And actually, this sounds like a really perverse thing perhaps to say in the middle of a global pandemic, but there is an opportunity to fundamentally shift how we're doing that work. I think actually that it's our community link workers and the 1,000 mental health and wellbeing workers that we've committed to, so that every by 2026, so that every GP practice has access to them. I think they are the key. I think they already play an excellent role. I have a good, really good relationship with my own community link worker in my constituency. They're absolutely invaluable in terms of the connections out to various different community initiatives, cultural programmes, art therapies, and the trust that the GPs have. And that community link worker is really, really heartwarming evident for me to see. So I do think there's two things we have to do. One is we'll invest in the community link workers, the mental health and wellbeing workers. But actually, one thing that Angus Robertson and I spoke about in a recent engagement was how do we ensure that this is a continual thread throughout our recovery process. And I'm very open-minded to seeing how that can be the case. But I think the paradigm shift really will come from those community, the link workers, plus the additional mental wellbeing workers that we've committed to.
Thank you for that. Yes, would you like to come in on that?
Yeah, just to follow up on that, I think the other bit of that equation, of course, is it's one thing people having the awareness that this is a good thing to do. Then is the question, where does one plug in to the arts and cultural offering? And are all arts and cultural organisations aware that they can play this part and should play this part? And how do we then get that partnership up and working at scale in the way that you highlighted is the challenge? Because there will always be early adopters, weren't there? And the challenge then is how do we make sure that we can ensure that this is a provision that is offered across the country without geographical or social demographic variances? And that again is something that is going to be a work in progress to make sure that we can match things up. You might imagine that in advance of a session like this, that we are well advised about the state of play and in our departmental settings. And I was really heartened to look at, and happy to go into some detail to share with the committee, because I think it shows that the things are happening. If we look, for example, at some of our national companies, when looking at the cultural side of things, the programmes that they are already involved in, I think, should give us great heart that there is a lot of work that's ongoing. The question that I would have, and I need to work with my Cabinet Secretary colleague here, is so that we can be satisfied that the areas that we are responsible for, that the transmission mechanism is there, So when, as Mr. Youssef outlined, the support workers are in place, the mental health professionals are there, and the GPs who would be pursuing the prescription of these opportunities, when all of that is in place, that we make sure that we have that sort of transmission mechanism, for want of a better description, about how that should work. And I think that, again, is the work in progress that we're going to have to make sure that the cogs or the gears are working in harmony.
Thank you. A quick final question, which is about the Christie Commission, which, as you know, is 11 years old now. And Hamza Youssef spoke about the silo working and trying to avoid that, which was, of course, one of the central tenets of the Christie Commission. Another main tenet of that commission was around preventing negative outcomes and preventative spend. And this is something that you'll be well aware of. But I just suppose 10 years on from Christie, what are your thoughts on progress?
I think we have made significant progress. I look at the health service, and every conversation I have with clinicians and every conversation I have with health and social care workers is geared towards prevention. And again, our funding, although I appreciate actually it can be difficult to necessarily see it within individual funding lines, our funding is again geared towards the preventative, and it has to be. I mean, given the scale of the challenge we are now facing in terms of our recovery, we have got to invest in preventative. And I just came back from another committee where Brian Whittle, MSP, was unsurprisingly asking me, of course, about the role of sport and physical activity in the preventative space. And again, it has to be across government. And it is a cross-government agenda here. So I work with the Education Secretary, for example, when it comes to how do we educate particularly young people, not exclusively, but particularly young people when it comes to their eating choices at a young age. And that is some work that's ongoing. So there's always going to be work to do in this. But the preventative agenda is our foremost agenda, actually, when it comes to our recovery. Moving forward.
Thank you. Quick comment?
I'll try and be quick, yep. Deputy Convener, but maybe this is an appropriate point to give some examples. You mentioned Christie and how long ago that made recommendations, and I'm struck when looking at the concrete examples that I kind of gave a sneak preview of, have actually been operating for some time. And the question then is, how do we make these scalable? So to give some concrete examples, the committee will be aware of Big Noise, as it's called, run by Sistema Scotland, which is the high quality music education and social change programme that works intensively with kids, with young people and families within specifically targeted communities. And benefits of that, how those relate to the national performance framework, child-focused well-being outcomes, increased resilience, happiness, sense of belonging, fulfilment, emotional well-being. This is a scalable program. So it's up and running. Do we recognise it for what it is? Yes, absolutely. Is there more that can be done with it? Yes, there is. Scottish Ballet, Dance for Health program across Scotland since 2013. So this is not just the last few years. This has been up and running for a while. It's considered a global leader in the field. Many referrals, particularly for those living with Parkinson's, with multiple sclerosis, they've already come from partner consultant neurologists at Ninewells Hospital, for example, and MediSchool, and the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital. This has been going for some time. Is it scalable? Yes, it is. National Theatre for Scotland just been running a two-year project addressing ageism, social isolation and transphobia, supporting recreational, artistic and social rights of the LGBT plus over 50s. Is that scalable? Yes, it is. National Museums for Scotland, tailored programmes for people with dementia, offering social experience connected to collections and reminiscing. I could go on from the National Museums. There's more that they've been doing. There are theatre groups who've been doing this. The Scottish Book Trust has been. So there is a wide range of things that are up and running, have been running for some time, relating to the Christie Commission recommendations. And the challenge is, how do we build on that really good work that is currently happening to make sure that as we scale up and have the wider awareness that these schemes are up and running, to make sure that they can then provide the capacity when the GPs that Deputy Convener was alluding to are adopting social prescribing across the piece. So that I think is going to be the challenge, the awareness that these schemes are there, and then is it at scale enough to satisfy the demand as this becomes more mainstream in the approach that we're trying to get between health and social care and culture and the arts.
Thank you for those answers. And can I now turn to colleagues' questions and start with Jenny Minto, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretaries. I reflect very positively on what the Cabinet Secretary for Culture has just said about Sistema and Big Noise, having been involved right at the start of that. And I think that's a really good example of different organisations pulling together to produce something that is so beneficial to those receiving it, but also those giving it as well. I also, looking at the Christie Commission, the thing about duplication, making sure we don't duplicate. And I'm interested just to hear, given that you were at the COVID committee earlier, what you think both areas, both health and culture, can learn from the work that has got people through the pandemic. So for example, I was in Oban and there was a fantastic piece of artwork, an art exhibition which people had used to help them get through COVID, the isolation side of things, and how we can use that to get us into the recovery and through recovery as well. If you've got any thoughts on that, Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, thanks to Jenny Minto for a really important question. So I think there's a lot in this space. So our approach thus far to using culture and the arts as a really important kind of social prescribing tool at the moment, as I say, has been largely through grant funding, local initiatives, and it's working and working really well. I think part of the learning, and it was part of the challenge the Deputy Convener put to me, is, well, how do we do this in a more systemic way? And that's where the conversations between Angus Roberts and I are really, really important. In terms of areas where I think we can get significant benefit, where the public can get significant benefit, for me, is in the mental health space, and particularly amongst young people, but not exclusively. And we know the challenges that we're facing in relation to CAMHS and the backlog of CAMHS, and I'll be the first to absolutely say that there was issues pre-pandemic and they've been exacerbated by the pandemic. But going back again to the points about Christie that you have raised and Deputy Convener raised, we want to look at the preventative. We want to look at how we can stop people getting to that crisis point. And when they get to the crisis point, of course, CAMHS will be there to assist and to help, and we've got to clear that backlog. But some of the work that we have funded, and it goes back to Angus Robertson's point here, that where we can scale up good initiatives, we should do that. The government, I think, again, holding our hands up, we can sometimes suffer from pilotitis. We need to be able to make sure we can scale up some of those good initiatives and do that within time. And if the pandemic has taught me anything, it's taught me a number of things, frankly, but one of the things it's taught me is that if there is a will to move quickly, we can move quickly. And that might mean that we don't quite get it 100% absolutely perfect first time going at it, but in the benefit risk analysis, you know, the benefit of going quickly, moving up, scaling up quickly, actually can have real benefits. So I definitely think in the mental health space there's a lot there. I could talk to many other areas, but I'm more kind of conscious of time. So I think a particular focus for us in this space will absolutely be on mental health, and particularly young people's mental health.
If I may just add to that, to kind of share, I think, where the challenge for us all in this is. So we agree with the concept. We understand there's already good work that's going on. We know that amongst the organisations, say, for example, in the culture space that are nationally known organisations that are doing things, that's one thing, and that's a good thing. Of course it is. The example that Jenny Minto has given is the classic challenge, I think, for how do we help, firstly, have an awareness of much that goes on out there in Scottish society that happens anyway. It's not necessarily funded by anybody. It could be voluntary. It can be third sector that are doing really, really good things. So how do we make sure that there is an awareness that that is happening? And how do we then make sure that those that are prescribing are also aware of that good work that's going on? And I think we did discuss this in a previous evidence session, which was how can we match up those sort of examples with those who will be socially prescribing? And I don't think we're there yet in working out how we can capture that information and make sure that then those people who are in a position to socially prescribe, for example, participation in a scheme in Argyll, can do that. Because I think it's going to be much easier to kind of go in the culture space, kind of go, well, what's Scottish Ballet doing? What are other performing companies? What are national museums? What is Historic Environment Scotland doing? Mm-hmm. I think that's one thing, mm-hmm. and that's going to be quite easy to identify because, you know, the memo will go out from Culture Central saying what's happening here. But how do we in the cultural part of Scottish Government and Creative Scotland and so on and so on, how do we know what's happening in Argyll? And so how do we work through that? And that's something that we're going to have to mm-hmm. we're going to have to make sure that we are capturing that. Because I think, I mean, I said this to the committee before, politicians don't do culture, nor should we. Yeah, it's for people who do culture and the arts to have the support that they're needed. And, you know, therein, you know, yes, let 1,000 flowers bloom, but we are trying to work out how can we incorporate all of that great practice that's going on out there and match that up with what we're trying to do in this example with health and social care. So to answer Jenny Minto's question, I'm not sure I have the answer. I have ideas. I'm not sure there is an answer. But so long as we're asking the question, I think we've got a better chance of getting there.
Mm-hmm. Thank you both. I've just jotted a few things down, collaboration and flexibility being two. And something I was having a conversation at the weekend about bringing people in with a cultural background in to look at the way we do things or the way that we budget. And I think that's perhaps an interesting way to move forward as well, because people are coming in with perhaps a different perspective as to how things could work. I'll just finish there, I think. I've dropped a wee pebble in and I'll have a wee think about it myself.
Need to open things up, because we certainly don't have time to do this. But I mean, there is also a question, and there's what is culture in this context? Because again, we can go establish cultural and arts community and organisations, and then it's very observable what a local arts or cultural group might be doing in Argyll, as Jenny Minto has said. But there are so many other things that we know from the research has an impact, but it might not be viewed as capital C culture, if that makes sense. Sorry, I'm not wanting to open up a sort of conceptual conversation, Deputy Convener, but I'm really keen that we are able to capture that as well. You know, for example, you know, gardening.
Well, yeah.
Allotments.
Yeah.
I mean, there are a whole series of things that wouldn't necessarily be thought of as being capital C culture, but do clearly impact on people's well-being, and it's part of a continuum of
Absolutely.
What might be offered and supported.
Yeah, I think that is a huge conversation to have.
It'll be a future evidence session, perhaps, Deputy Convener.
I'm normally well up for a big conceptual discussion like that, but I think in the time available, we will move on to Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much, Convener. Mr. Yusuf, you've talked about breaking down the barriers between silos, and I think this is something that's come up in a committee before when we're talking about budgets and the relationship between health and culture. Of course, apart from the department that you run centrally, there are territorial health boards. So I just wondered, do these messages about working across these barriers, do they get through to health boards? I mean, what can you do to ensure that they're thinking about culture? And what is the culture of culture in health boards? Given the pressures that they're under, you know, how do they accommodate some of these ideas?
Yes. The Deputy Committee wanted to avoid a conceptual discussion and then went to Dr. Allen, of all people. I only say that. I say that tongue-in-cheek. Of course I do. The question is a very pertinent one. So I meet regularly with the chief executives and chairs and public health directors, for example, of health boards, and of course that includes Western Isles Health Board. But actually the challenge isn't just... So we will show leadership, but the challenge isn't just me communicating my expectations to the health board. There is a whole level of management below that, which is going to be crucial. And that gets to your point about the culture, again, small-c culture within health boards. And you know, those people who are on the ground, again, senior management, I expect to be really close to a ground level, and that may be easier in slightly smaller health boards to do. I expect it in larger health boards too, but can be more challenging. Can be challenging in rural health boards and the scale of size of NHS Highland, for example. And so we really rely on every part of the management structure understanding what my direction and is as Cabinet Secretary for Health in this regard. So the challenge, and being upfront about it, has been that the vast majority of our conversations that I have had with health boards, as you can imagine, has been about the immediate pressures of the pandemic and our recovery from that. What I'm really keen to do is when we get into some of more of the detail about that recovery, which of course we are absolutely doing, not to lose sight of that. So actually it may well be worthwhile, considering how I bring in the likes of the Cabinet Secretary into those conversations with chief executives and chairs of health boards, and actually not just doing it for Angus Robertson, but actually for some of my other Cabinet Secretary colleagues too. So it's an important point raised by Dr. Allen, and one that we can make further progress on.
There's a parallel point to this, of course, which is it's not just health boards. It's where are local authorities as part of this conversation as well, and in terms of being joined up. There are some outstanding examples of local authorities and their arts officers, for example, who are already doing a lot of the work in the area that we're talking about. And so how is it that we are pulling together all of this best practice as we go forward with things? Now, we all know that different local authorities will have their own local priorities, and that's quite right and proper. And for some of them, they will view the likes of arts officers as being a priority. In other places, they don't. So there is a conversation to be had, and I'm very careful not to be steering and instructing local government colleagues on this front. But if we are agreeing that it is a national priority, and you know, I count some of these local arts officers as personal friends of mine, and so I know exactly the value that they bring, and especially in the areas that we've been talking about. So this goes back to my point about how do we bring all of this together to make sure that we are delivering across the piece and across government. And I think that by bringing people at a local level as well as national government and then local authorities on a national level through the conventional Scottish local authorities into this, I think is definitely going to be one of the pieces that we're going to have to make sure forms a jigsaw puzzle of getting us to where we want to get to in this area.
Thank you. And my only other question again for Mr. Robertson. Visitors to Scotland often comment on the effect on their well-being of being able to see Scotland's natural environment, see historic buildings and so on. there must be a huge potential, one would have thought, for working between health and culture to utilise the resource that is, I suppose, simply Scotland itself. And I, of course, there are many people who don't know that those opportunities are there for them, or who know that they're there but who can't afford to go and visit places around the country. So is there more that can be done to try and break down some of those barriers that might be caused by deprivation in some cases?
Indeed. And that's where this is not just an issue of social prescribing and so on, for example, mental health outcomes, worthy though that is and important though that is. In terms of the government's priorities, it is also a huge opportunity to address other priorities, such as dealing with social deprivation and so on. And I think there is much more that can be done with, as has been outlined, the heritage, the natural heritage that we have, well, the natural environment and the built heritage that we have, and making sure that we have much more accessibility. And this is something that I've been talking with colleagues in culture about. What is it that we can do to bridge that gap? And I think there are a number of imaginative ways in which we can do it. And I think there are some encouraging ways in which we can scale that up quite quickly. Dr. Allen's asking the right question. We're still at a stage of working out how is it that we can bridge that gap, how can we make that happen? And this all needs to be seen within the context of the spending constraints that we are operating under, and where the Cabinet Secretary for Finance sitting she's sitting there virtually in my mind, because we're having to be extremely thoughtful about what is it that we're able to do with these constraints in imaginative ways that might not cost money, or where we can identify other funding streams to make this happen. But for me, the key point is it has to happen. So then how do we make it happen? So that's very much where the discussion is. And again, I say to the committee, if you have views on that, I'm really, really keen to hear that, because I think there are ways of finding and marshalling resources that should make this possible, and I'm very keen to make sure it happens.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you for that. Just one observation on that, listening to that last exchange. It's plainly important not to forget about social care in this conversation, and with the design of the National Care Service coming up, but you just hope, and I'm sure it is, that the cultural considerations and mainstreaming that conversation is taking place as well in terms of social care.
I can give you a very brief reassurance in the conversation that the Cabinet Secretary and I had. We discussed the National Care Service and then discussed that very issue. And again, going back to my point that these matters shouldn't be seen as a bolt-on. We're much better to include consideration of culture, the arts, the benefit of that from a health and wellbeing perspective at the inception stage, as opposed to towards the end. And the very last thing I would say is on social care, and Angus Robertson was absolutely right to reference that point about local authorities. Our integration authorities right across the country are already doing this work, and many of them are doing it very, very well. The challenge for us is sometimes the inconsistency across the country, so that's where the National Care Service might be able to help with that. But it goes to the very core, actually, it was of your original question, around the preventative space. Mm-hmm. So to give you a reassurance, absolutely being considered as part of the National Care Service.
very pleased to hear that. Sorry, Cabinet Secretary,
add to it. I mean, I think this is one of the really exciting opportunities with all the work that's going on, thinking about the National Care Service, of this being a priority right at the inception. Mm-hmm. So as things are being put in place, as the thoughts are being made about how should this come together and how should this work, that the considerations that we are now looking at form part of that thinking right at the start. So it's not something that one's then having to add on later, but it's right there at the beginning. And so I think the timing is very opportune.
Thank you. Can I turn now to Sarah Boyack, please, for questions?
Thanks, Convener. On one level, this is really heartening, because I think the Cabinet Secretaries are saying the kind of things we'd like to hear. But in a year's time, post-pandemic, what will you be able to show us that's changed? Because Cabinet Secretary for Health, as the convener said at the start, Christie Commission, 11 years on, we haven't seen the transformative change. We can all quote brilliant projects locally, but they are facing massive post-pandemic pressure. And this morning's evidence was our local authorities have had a decade of cuts and culture isn't core funded. So there's a real issue about 2026 for GP access. That's 15 years on from Christie. And we know that, and both of you have basically said it, that preventative spending is not just good, but really important in terms of pandemic recovery. So what is the kickstart approach to actually deliver this on the ground? And we will lobby the Cabinet Secretary for Culture, feels like on a weekly basis, but you've got the big budget that potentially cuts right across our community. So what can happen in the health budget that is the transformative issue? So it's not just link workers, but their support to work with those local projects on the ground so that they're still there in a year's time.
Yeah, so I suppose the first thing I would say is that, and the Cabinet Secretary made reference to this, that we're not starting from base zero. It would be wrong to suggest that there hasn't been progress since the Christie Commission 11 years ago. I could point to and I can give you numerous examples, if you wish, around how we've managed to make some inroads in relation to that preventative spend in terms of outcomes. Sorry, I'm getting a bit of pickup from somewhere. So we could give you examples of that, and I'm happy to provide the committee examples either now or if you want them, for example, in writing. I'm happy to provide those. And actually, the community link workers are an example of that. We have 200 community link workers in place, based or in or aligned to a GP practice or indeed a GP cluster. So we are not starting again from base zero. So we talk about those 1,000 additional mental health and wellbeing workers that every GP practice will have access to. They're going to be building upon the good work of the 200 that we already have in place. The second thing is, in terms of our recovery, that NHS recovery plan that we have, which is for the period of this parliamentary term, I'm saying now very clearly that we're going to embed social prescribing as part of that, and as part of that, of course, culture and the arts will feature. And then it goes to national leadership. So again, it kind of refers back to the question that Dr. Allen asked me. If I am providing that leadership, and we are collectively providing that leadership, and our expectation of health boards, integration authorities, local authorities, about the importance of this agenda in our health and wellbeing, and particularly perhaps focusing on some key areas like mental health and young people's mental health, and providing the necessary funding in that respect, then I think we will continue to make transformative change in budgets. You're right to ask those questions about budgets. You know, we often hear and know that saying very well. You know, show me your budget and I'll tell you your priorities. £18 billion, a record £18 billion, going in health and social care in the next financial year, and using the weight and the muscle of that budget for the outcomes that we've discussed is something that I'm very keen to do.
Just to clarify, I didn't say there had been no progress since Christie.
No, I
was
that.
I was basically, the thing to look at, I think, from the Cabinet Secretary's perspective is the Auditor General for Scotland's blog, Christie's clarion call, Can't Wait Another Decade, and the Interim Chair of the Accounts Commission published Christie, It Really Is Now or Never, in October. So it's those kind of representations we're really trying to get centre stage here. And I think for the Cabinet Secretary for Culture, the evidence we've had, Send Scot, Create a Scotland, Audit Scotland and COSLA, highlighting the massive pressures from the pandemic, which Cabinet Secretary will know about, we've talked about. So is that issue about what is the recovery strategy going to look like, and what's going to change? And I'd particularly be interested in your views on the recommendations from the National Partnership for Culture and how you see funding coming, which could be from the culture budget, could be from the health budget, could be from the local government budget, but it's what are those funding streams going to look like as a recovery plan, not just the short term, but that long term, multi-year funding that we've had calls for?
So much in those questions there, Boy. Thank you very much. So firstly, on the recovery plan, I think the most important thing, and we've discussed this already, is getting from a government perspective, is getting government to understand that culture is important across government. So the mainstream of thinking and approach across government. And this is an example. This is what we're talking about today. So point one, we've identified this. Two, we're doing it. We're trying our best to work our way through it. And the recommendations that Sarah Boyack is talking about, have received them, and they are to be published shortly. And I think we should be looking closely at what those recommendations are, and we should be taking them seriously. So happy to come back when we're at that stage. But you know, I go back to the original question: where will we be in a year's time? And it's exactly the right question. So I know where you all are going to be, and I know where I'm going to be, because I'm going to be sitting in this chair, and you're going to be saying, we're now a year on from when you said we're starting to do this and that, and we're not beginning from a position where progress has not been made since Christie, it has been. But how do we scale it up? How do we make it delivered right across the country? That is the challenge. And we will have to play our part in making sure that we're doing that, given the constraints that Sarah Boyack has identified as well. But I am optimistic, well, for one thing, because I think there is consensus that this is what needs to happen, point one. I'm not sure if you've heard any evidence that this is not the way we should be approaching things going forward. So there's consensus. So it's how do we make that happen and happen consistently? And, you know, I am optimistic that there will be considerable change and improvement, and I'm excited about playing a part in making that happen, because I think it will be transformational for people, and we just need to make sure that we're doing it so it reaches as many people as possible.
I think that's a welcome commitment, and you're booked for a year from now.
I'm going to be back here, but I'm not waiting a year. At the moment, I'm coming here every week, Deputy Convener, so I would be massively disappointed if you're only having me back in a year's time.
The test is, I suppose, not just the culture and creative budgets.
Yeah.
It's that right across the public sector. So I suppose that is the question from the Scottish Government in terms of cross-government working. What are the budget issues in terms of going back to the Cabinet Secretary for Health, the preventative spend benefits are that you save money, but you have to start the expenditure to get the infrastructure in. So it's just a plea to go back to the very opening comment you meant about 2026 GP access, because the evidence we've had in social prescribing is that it could be a very critical way to help people not just get through the pandemic, but to recover from the pandemic, and that cuts across culture, but clearly mental health and well-being for young people, older people, people in low incomes. Yeah. And we got evidence today that it's not reaching the low-income communities in the way we'd want. So it's how you make that transformative change now.
Yeah. I mean, probably little for me to add other than to agree with Sarah Boyack. And I think the point I would make is we talk about a year from now, and although I'm hopefully very confident that we'll be out of the immediate grip of the pandemic a year from now, and we're making progress in the absolutely right direction. This week and the last couple of weeks have felt extremely difficult, but we will get through this wave as we have done other waves. The challenge of the NHS recovery is going to take years. I don't think there's any government, certainly across the UK, that would suggest otherwise. And I think the second point to make is, to agree with Sarah Boyack, is how people access their health service may well also change. So GP access is a good example. We want to restore where we can, as much as we possibly can, access, face-to-face access to GPs. But we know that will be part of a hybrid model, telephone, video consultation, face-to-face. And we've got to make sure that our digital infrastructure, and I know this is a particular issue within the NHS, our digital infrastructure keeps up with that. But if we're going to do that through digital, then we've got to take the points on that Sarah Boyack mentions, which is digital exclusion. We know that inequality exists more so in areas of deprivation. If I was to think about the pandemic, and I'll just finish on this point, there's no way anybody can truthfully say that we were all in this together. We weren't. There are people and communities that have been harder hit by the pandemic, and those in areas of deprivation. Well, look at the excess death figures, for example, 2.5 times more likely to have died for COVID. So we cannot say that we were in this all together. And therefore, any solutions and any work that we do, the Cabinet Secretary and I, to build upon culture and the arts as being part of mental health and well-being and physical health and well-being solutions to the future has to be on an equitable basis. And that may well mean, and this is something those who are involved in the Deep End project who might be known to the committee say to me very often, that we've got to make sure that we continue to direct the resources into those communities that need them the most.
Thank you.
And finally, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Perhaps I might start with the Cabinet Secretary for Health. Clearly, within the health portfolio, there's lots of metrics and targets. How, or what is your assessment of how NHS boards and even down to GP practices can better report activities within the context of culture?
Thank you for what's a really good question, and actually it's not too dissimilar to a question I just had at the COVID-19 committee, and that was based on evidence they took from GPs and those staff side representative organisations that represent GPs, and the message coming very clearly was that we need to improve our data from primary care. There's just no getting away from that. I've said this from day one in my job. And there is something about, of course, the fact that we have a particular independent contractor model, which is different, obviously, to the model that we have within our NHS acute services. And therefore, we've got to work within those IT systems to be able to extract data far better than we are doing at the moment. So there is a project underway, some funding underway to assist with that project, which is going to help us to extract far greater data than we currently have. The good thing is that in the initial extraction of that data, I think it was close to 95% of GP practices participated in that initial extract of the data, which has come to me. We're then now getting it quality assured and so on and so forth. And then once that is done, we'll absolutely publish that data. But it's going to be key. It's absolutely right. You know, if you were to try to extract data around social prescribing, for example, it would be patchy, and therefore it has to be improved.
Thanks for that. And in a similar vein, how can we better get data from local authorities on their cultural activities pertaining to health, but actually more generally?
So this is an area that Jenny Gilruth, before she recently took up responsibilities for transport, was in dialogue with local authorities about. And I know that her successor, Neil Gray, is now very focused, as we might all imagine, and we wish him well, in supporting the refugees from Ukraine. It's definitely a dialogue that needs to continue so that we better understand where things are with local authority partners. So I think it's an area that we can be doing more, working in partnership with local authority colleagues, and I'm very keen that we do.
Thanks for that. And a supplementary to the Cabinet Secretary for Culture, we've heard this morning about a kind of financial squeeze within the culture and leisure sector, whereby costs are going up and funding has been reduced. And this could have an impact on terms of developing additional services in the context of health. But I was also wondering, in terms of another cross-departmental government working of achieving net zero and the impact of the cultural sector, particularly when you think of museums, the assessment of cost, which from the evidence we've heard, no one's looked at yet, and what support the Scottish Government could give to provide that assessment of cost, of retrofitting, of energy efficiency to the cultural sector.
Yep, and not just museums and galleries, but you could add to that the very significant, can't call it housing stock, but you know what I'm trying to say in relation to Historic Environment Scotland, mm-hmm. in terms of the built environment that we have, which similarly there's a dimension to that which feeds very much into the net zero side of things. So yeah, we are very conscious of that, and it's something that we need to understand better, and we are engaged in making sure that we do that. But I mean, again, it's the right question, and we need to get the answers for both of those reasons, both for the net zero side of things, but then also for the sort of cultural resource, if one wants to call it that, or opportunity that we can have, going back to the earlier discussion about the sort of partnership working between national companies, culture on a nationally funded level, but then also at a local authority level. And at the heart of, I don't want to put words in Maurice Golden's mouth, but I think we're talking about just trying to unlock as much of the resource allocation which is already there. So again, it's not about reinventing the wheel, it's just about how do we get everything to work as well as we possibly can and identify if there are gaps somewhere. And the only way that we'll know if there are gaps, and so if we're getting that data back, so whether that's from the health side of things, but then also from the culture side of things, and that's definitely a takeaway for me to work out what is the quality of that information. And happy to come back, or you know, if it just for Maurice Golden's benefit, but if committee colleagues are interested in finding it more, happy to share that with colleagues as well.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much. I mean, it's just my final observation is one of priorities, and just directed to the Cabinet Secretary for Health, really. You spoke about some of the most challenging weeks you've had in the pandemic over the last sort of month or so. We all know about the recovery longer term and the need, whether it be waiting lists, waiting times or whatever. And you can understand that, you know, cultural cross portfolio working will not be high on the priority list for a health board or in government more generally. And I suppose it's a plea that notwithstanding all these understandable pressures that the health service is under to maintain culture and the importance of it and the mainstreaming that we've spoken about going forward.
Yeah. No, look, thank you for putting the plea and putting it on the record. Again, if I can give you some assurance, and I'm not going to treat anybody around this table like a fool at all. We are under significant pressure, and there are a huge number of priorities. But the pandemic and the recovery from that pandemic is at the top of it. But I don't see what we're discussing as being separate to that. The challenge will be how, and this goes to Dr. Allen's point, how do we embed that within the recovery? And that's where there's a piece of work that we're admitting has got to be done here on the recovery. And if we can embed it in first principles as part of that recovery, as part of the National Care Service, then it's going to be far easier moving forward. So I don't see them as I say, kind of separate, a nice to do, a bolt on. We already have some good practice, particularly as I say, in the mental health space. How do we build upon that and as I say, make it as part of our recovery moving forward?
Thank you. Well, can I thank you both very much and your officials for your time this morning. It's been a very fruitful session, and in the spirit of the cross-portfolio working that we've all been discussing. So thank you very much indeed, and can I hereby close the meeting?